startup companies and technology waiting in the wings to help us transform healthcare and healthcare delivery. There are also new market entrants. JP Morgan Chase, Berkshire Hathaway, two financial companies, and Amazon recently created a joint venture, or a triple venture. I guess it's not a joint venture, but it's three. So they created this venture with the sole focus of reducing healthcare costs. Warren Buffett said last week, if you think this is just about our employees, think again. We're going to take what we develop within this venture and take it to change the cost of healthcare for the entire country. So I take notice of that sort of partnership, because think about Amazon. How many of you have shopped on Amazon before? They are so good at figuring out what I want to buy. And they're really good at reminding me it's time to buy more dog food, or you know, it's time to buy some other product that I use all the time. Now think about that in terms of a chronically ill patient that may have needs for services that we haven't identified as a system. But the electronic system could identify for that patient and then connect them with that resource. So they have competency that could really help transform population health and improve the healthcare of patients while reducing the cost. I didn't mention, but it's on the slide, with workforce shortages. And certainly New Mexico is familiar with that, all but one county being a federally designated healthcare workforce shortage area. And Dr. Richard's report, I think, points out significant shortages in the behavioral health area. And the AAMC is projecting 95,000 physicians short by 2025. So that will certainly impact and challenge academic medical centers to have enough providers, not just physicians, but nurses and other healthcare providers, to continue to provide care in new ways and in our traditional ways. And last, I'd mention the regulatory environment. It's very chaotic and totally unpredictable. One of my favorite things to do is to listen to the lobbyists that work in healthcare and the advocates that work in healthcare, because they have no idea what to say anymore. It's usually 30 minutes of comedy and no real information about what to anticipate in the environment anymore. So that is a significant challenge, but I think one thing is for sure is that we can plan on, as the Brookings Institute pointed out, no big windfalls of new revenue as academic medical centers from the federal government or from our state governments. So lots of challenge and lots of transformation in the industry. And as the Brookings Institute article pointed out 18 years ago, and really every article since then about what will academic medical centers do to survive this new marketplace, it's going to require transformative change. And so I boil this down to five transformations for academic health centers. So the first transformation is focusing on value. Having high quality that you can demonstrate and a reasonable cost that you can demonstrate publicly is what I would call, I'm a non-gambler, table stakes. So it's bare minimum requirements for being successful in the marketplace. So it's imperative that organizations have a focus on improving those quality measures and to focus on zero defects. So I know, and I've worked in academic medical centers, that we get really proud of our measures when they're above average. But if it's you that gets the central line infection, or it's one of your loved ones, above average doesn't feel good enough. So academic medical centers, as leaders in the field, need to be striving for zero defects. Now this kind of work starts with the basics. It starts with, and at UTMB, we've made the transformation we made with the basics first. So having a team that's multidisciplinary, interprofessional, that's focused on driving the change, educating that team on how the metrics work and what levers to pull that would be most significant in improving the outcomes, and aligning incentives and focus around achieving those results. That's how we've transformed our quality scores. So it's not awe-inspiring or really innovative work. It's back to the basics to get to the top of the pack. Now, to get to zero defects, that's where the innovation comes in. And once you've got the basics down, you, academic medical centers ought to be focusing on how to drive out error and waste in the system and to get to zero defects. The other focus in driving value is cost. And at UTMB, we developed a program called Patient-Centered Resource Optimization Program. It's a mouthful. I didn't name it. I actually asked a couple of the faculty to help me name it, because I knew it needed a name, and I wanted something that wouldn't cause the faculty to roll their eyes when they heard it, and so that's what they came up with. So we started this program, and the purpose of the program was to create cost transparency within the organization, and to work on clinical practice variation. It's a physician-led program. We bring faculty together, sometimes in interprofessional settings, sometimes just the faculty, to look at the cost and quality of care that's being provided around specific episodic DRGs. So we look at, for example, CABG. And we look at all of our faculty's cost and quality data together, scorecard it, get them together as a group and talk about what's driving the differences, what's our total cost look like, and what can we do to improve the cost that will also either maintain the quality or enhance the quality. That program in 1 year realized $7.2 million in savings just by providing the information and facilitating a dialogue. And that program, my vision with it, is really to create that kind of cost transparency as a status quo in the organization. So providers and staff can know what things cost in the environment and make prudent decisions in the interest of their patients and the organization. So as I said before, this kind of work is the basics for surviving the new healthcare market. And so Transformation 1 is really focusing on driving value. Now Transformation 2 is a bit more innovative work. It's how do we adapt and participate in what is happening in terms of transforming of alternative payment models in the marketplace. And this work is work that needs to include our patients. It needs to include our community and a number of community providers, because many of the solutions that are going to be derived here don't happen within the confines of the hospital. They're going to happen in the patient's home. And we'll focus on strategies to deliver more of that care in the patient's home. And we're seeing that already in the industry. In New York and even here in Albuquerque, Presbyterian have home hospital programs. Most patients after a hospitalization want to go where? To a nursing home? How many of you want to go to a nursing home after your hospitalization? Right, you want to go home. And so finding innovative ways to get patients home and to lower the healthcare cost for the population and having new ways to care for patients is essential work in participating in alternative payment models, where the organization becomes at risk for how much the patient costs the whole entire system, both inpatient, ambulatory, and in the home environment. So this is very innovative work. It is also work that requires tolerance of failure, because most organizations, if they have any sense, will tell you they're trying a bunch of things and some things work and some things don't. So it's important to have a tolerance for failure and to really squeeze as much learning out of the failure and squeeze as much learning out of the success to leverage those things into the next test of change. The third transformation is patient and family-centered care, which I talked about was a very important practice for me in my leadership practice. And whether you read the high reliability literature around safety or you read the literature from the ILM or AHRQ or any of the quality bodies, they will tell you patient and family-centered care is a significant strategic effort that ought to be deployed by academic medical centers. It's a strategy that I've deployed at UTMB. We have a patient advisor that sits with us on our operations council each week. We had patients involved in the design of all of our healthcare facilities, clinics, hospitals, and so forth. We've had patients involved in the design of our strategies for alternative payment models and our value-based contracts. And we involve patients in transforming our medicine teaching service. Our chair of medicine called me up one day and he said, I want to have a meeting with you because I want to talk about the medicine teaching service. We need to fix it. And I was a little bit confused because I'm not an expert in medical education and I'm not an expert in RRC rules. And I thought, what am I going to have to offer for this discussion? So I went to Dr. Urban's office and we started talking and he told me what some of the problems were that he saw. And I remembered my days working with the continuity clinic at UAB. And I said something kind of offhand to Dr. Urban. I said, hey, what if we just talk to the patients about what they think it should look like? And what if we started there, forget the RRC rules for a minute, and let's start with the patients and let them inform us on how the model should work. And then we can bring back in the RRC rules and medical education expertise and layer that in with what the patients think will work best. And so that's what we did. And that model improved our patient satisfaction on the unit. It reduced our length of stay, it reduced our readmission rates, and it improved our faculty satisfaction with the teaching service. So that's one example of many where patients can help us come up with new models of care that are better and less expensive and higher quality by just contributing their experience and practical wisdom that sometimes we think we know as providers but miss because of either regulation or history or just not having had the experience firsthand ourselves. The fourth transformation is portfolio management. And this is where I'm gonna get a little businessy on you. So portfolio management is something academic medical centers have traditionally been challenged with. Our solution to most problems in academic medical centers and throughout my career is build more capacity and fill it. And that produces more revenue, and that revenue solves a lot of problems. That strategy in the current market doesn't work anymore in most places because lower acuity care and even medium acuity care is being what they call commoditized. So it's the price on that is being driven, that the payers will pay and the federal government will pay, it's being driven down, which means our academic environment with its rich teaching and research and the cost that it costs us to provide care makes that care unable for us, it makes it unable for us to profit from that or to have a margin. And so payers are channeling and funneling that kind of care to other providers, community providers, that can provide that at essentially the same quality in most cases and for a lower cost. Now, we can still provide that care, but we're going to provide that care at a loss, which means not having enough resources in the institution to invest in capital equipment, to invest in raises, to invest in new staff, to invest in new facilities. So it's important that we have a strategy that's focused in a way that will produce a margin that will allow us to do the things that we all want to do, which is have facilities that are appropriate to take care of our patients in, be able to give raises to staff, be able to have fair wages, and to be able to invest in equipment and new technologies we're going to need to better take care of our patients. So this is a challenge because we have educational missions and we have research missions, and it's sometimes hard for academic medical centers to focus and align strategically across the enterprise. But it's become more essential because of the changes in reimbursement that we're facing. And the last transformation that I want to talk about is probably the most critical, and that's workforce development. Because if you're in a transformative time and you're expecting to move the organization in a new direction, you can't do that without working first with your faculty and staff, who need to be prepared for the kinds of changes that we're facing, who need to be supported to be successful with new competencies to be able to deliver on these transformations. And you need a healthy work environment I talked earlier about transforming quality and bringing the voice of the patient to what we do. That work requires a certain level of vulnerability that requires a healthy work environment. At UTMB, we're deploying the AACN model for a healthy work environment, which has multiple components, meaningful recognition, good communication, authentic leadership, and there's some more. I would add one thing to their model, which is a sincere commitment by leadership to with faculty and staff to make workflows and the electronic health record easier to interact with to help return the joy to their work. And I say that because in the time I spend shadowing and with physicians at physician dinners or our employee breakfast, it's a complaint and a concern that I hear very consistently from our faculty and staff. It's in the literature. Every week I read about physician burnout, nursing burnout, other healthcare professional burnout. And a big part of that burnout, if you read the literature, is the daily struggle to do the basic things. Inefficient process, an electronic health record that sometimes feels like it's getting in the way of providing good care versus supporting the provider to get the work done more effectively. And so organizations need to focus resource and effort in addressing those things, finding new ways for things to happen, what I call automagically. So finding technology that can deliver, the IT folks are probably like, oh my gosh, automagically, really? So automagically where, one thing we implemented recently at UTMB was a product called HealthFinch. It's a bolt-on to our electronic record. It automatically refills prescriptions with minimal human interaction. There are certain prescriptions that you want renewed. And if you've got the right lab values or you've got the blood pressure that says it should be renewed, why not have that happen automatically versus have human interaction that's not adding value and probably slowing down the patient getting what they need? So leadership has to be sincerely committed to finding ways to improve the work environment and the daily workflow for our faculty and our staff. Of course, with the workforce shortages, there have to be planning for workforce shortages and new roles developed in the new healthcare models to support the organization in the future. So I have a big disadvantage from everyone in this room. I haven't lived in Albuquerque before, and I've not worked at University of New Mexico Health System before. So some of this might seem really off the wall or not like a good strategy for here. So I'm going to qualify those five transformations and say some of them would likely need to be tweaked for the environment here. And I think it's important to acknowledge that. I know there's a famous saying that says you've seen one academic medical center and you've seen one academic medical center. And that uniqueness is important to recognize. And as a new CEO for an organization like University of New Mexico, as you come into the organization, it's critically important to, yes, understand the community, yes, understand the market data, but spend lots and lots and lots of time listening. Listening to the board, listening to stakeholders, faculty and staff, internal to the organization, community members external to the organization, to understand how to effectively transform the organization. It's important to understand the stories that empowers the dialect and the way things get done within the organization. So that way, as the new CEO, you can leverage the history and strengths of an organization like University of New Mexico and help drive that transformation into the new healthcare marketplace. So with that said, I'd like to turn the time over to you for questions. But before I do that, I wanted to take an opportunity to thank you for the opportunity to learn more about your organization, to get to meet many of you and get to know you a little better. I've really enjoyed it and have found it incredibly inspiring to get to know more about University of New Mexico. So thank you.
Well, Deb, as we start to take questions from the audience, I'll start off with one. Okay, so you focus on transformation and consulting groups like McKinsey will say that organizations that have good leadership, good vision, and a good track record of execution, that only 30% of them actually can achieve true transformation. So what do you think distinguishes those that are able to do it from those organizations that aren't?
I would say engagement of faculty and staff. Because it doesn't matter if you've got great leaders, if they can't connect with faculty and staff to make it happen. Without that, the organization goes nowhere, because I can only do so much individually. It requires the whole organization understanding what's happening, understanding, I know you've got a Studer engagement, so I'll borrow from Studer, understanding the why it's happening and why the organization is doing what it's doing. And getting agreement internally that the direction is the right direction for the organization and for the community.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Steve Liu, and I'm a trauma surgeon here, mm-hmm. briefly.
Thank you for sitting in the front row. I appreciate that.
My wife's from U City, actually, so she's very familiar with St. Louis. So it's great that you brought up the physician engagement piece. I'm the chair-elect, Melissa Ivers is our actual chair, for the physician advocacy group here. And so I'm sure you're aware that we are in the single digits for both provider alignment and engagement. So it sounds like in your early career, you were recruited because providers felt like you understood their concerns, right? But now you're the CEO, and you're not going to be able to individually engage with all those frontline providers. And in your millennial question, you said there's no one here, right? So obviously, none of our frontline people are here.
Well, we've got three millennials in back. I'm sorry.
I think that's about our.
You're going to
usual...
help us.
I mean, and clearly, so that's about what our frontline people feel, right? That they are not engaged in these discussions, right? Mm-hmm. So, what is your strategy to bring your individual talents for engagement down to the larger organization and the larger front line? Mm-hmm.
So, I'll tell you some of what I've done, and I think I won't comment on what's the right strategy for here, because I think that would be silly for me to do that without having more information, okay? So, but I will tell you that the practice that I do of shadowing every week is something I will continue throughout my career. I will be out, if I come to UNM, I will be out on the units, that interaction is invaluable to what I do as a leader. And it does create a connection. I have other forums as well as that, which I would continue. And you're right, I don't get to connect with every single person in the organization, but I can tell you in my organization, when I walk in the morning, people know who I am, we stop, we chat, we talk. If there's a problem, they tell me about it. If there is a challenge, they tell me about it. We have a dialogue about it. Some of it's work that needs to be solved at a unit level, at an individual level, and we talk through that. But that kind of connection, I think, is essential for leaders to have that kind of connection. I also do faculty dinners at UTMB, where we invite frontline faculty that aren't in traditional leadership roles necessarily, so we can hear what's on their mind. What are they thinking? So those are important, I think, habits for an organization to have. And just having some of those habits will change the way the whole organization interacts. We created leader standard work for our managers and directors, which included spending time in their own environments. Now, we had to do some changes organizationally to create time for them to do that, because they were stuck in too many meetings at that point, so we needed to free up some time to allow them to do that and to be present in their environments. So from an organizational perspective, it's important to find ways for all levels of leadership to have time to spend in their environments and to find the right communication channels to get the information to the front line so they understand why is the organization doing that. Every time I shadow, I have a staff member that will ask me, well, why are you doing this or why are you doing that? I love those questions because it gives me an opportunity to share information which then gets disseminated. And over the 5 years I've been at UTMB, when people come to the breakfast or when I come to Shadow Now, they usually have talked to their colleagues and they have a list of questions or things they want addressed to take back and share with the whole environment. So those informal communication channels are really important, as well as formal communication channels, either regular updates on here's what's going on in the organization, and finding the right way to do that is important because no one really wants another email. Right? So either doing email communication or blogs or Twitter, this is where the millennials are going to have to help me on this stuff. So finding new avenues to connect and communicate and share that message. Does that help? Are you not satisfied? Mediocre satisfied on that?
I think that's a great start.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning. My name is Nicole Rogers with the Department of Nursing Excellence. I've been with the hospital for 2.5 years. And you mentioned why, and that's one of my passions, is revitalizing our why. Can you tell me your why for being in healthcare and for why you would like this position?
So I think I'd go back to my first slide with my sweet grandmother's picture on it. This career allows me to live a life and have a career in the service of other people. That's my why. And why University of New Mexico? Because I think there's great alignment in that motivation and in my values and the values of this organization and what it aspires to do and what it has done in its history to support the community here.
So do we have any community members that would like to ask questions today?
Sorry, no one else is asking questions.
Since
you brought up the issue of efficiencies of care and the choices involved in prioritizing those missions, so clearly UNM has a huge safety net mission.
Okay.
And also, like Dr. Richards has said multiple times, right, that UNM is a very cost-inefficient venue for providing that care. So I guess more in your role currently at Galveston, you know, how has Galveston UTMB addressed, you know, that contradiction in order to fulfill a safety net mission?
Yeah, so part of the strategy in Galveston was to develop our ambulatory presence and develop a community hospital presence. So we acquired a county hospital about an hour away. We acquired we built a community hospital of our own about 30 minutes away. So having other venues of care within the system there has been part of that strategy. So outside of the traditional academic medical center, we have other venues where we can provide lower acuity care in a community setting. And the challenge we've had with that, quite frankly, has been how do we, as folks that work in academic medicine with less experience in a community setting, develop and cultivate those community hospitals and without overlaying our traditions of academic medical center that may hurt them from being efficient and successful. And how do we still capitalize on having a new environment to teach learners? So that's one of the strategies. The other strategy is that program I talked about, the PROP program, the Patient-Centered Resource Optimization Program. So we've been trying to look at waste and clinical practice variation and partnering with our faculty to do that, giving them the data and stepping back and giving them support and stepping back and letting them have a discussion. And those discussions have been very fruitful. I have a cardiac surgeon who leads that program for me. He's a great guy. He said, Deb, well, if I'm going to do this work, I should start with my own service. And we went through the cost data and we began to develop the model we were going to use to present the data. And we pulled together his group's data and he's like, holy cow, I'm a cost outlier. And I'm like, that's a problem if you're going to leave this program and you're the cost outlier. So we figured out, well, what was driving that? And he was using something in the OR that he didn't know was adding an additional $500 per case to every one of his cases. And he said, that's not worth $500 more, and my colleagues aren't using that, and my outcomes are not any better than theirs. Maybe I should get rid of that. So he's gotten rid of that, and he's now on the other side of his colleagues in terms of that, which is good because he's the leader of that program, and he needs to model that behavior, which is exactly what he did, which is why he's a great leader for that program. But there are practical things like that that you can do internal to the organization to help lower that cost.
Good morning, my name is Preston Burgess. I'm the quality consultant in the quality outcomes department. I emphasize in the ambulatory. And Dr. Liu alluded to the fact that we don't have hardly any frontline folks here. We have a lot of leaders, and I think your message resonates with leaders talking about transformation. But would you change your message if you had a room full of frontline providers and staff here? And how would you change it?
Probably wouldn't change the message because the story is the same. I'd be more attentive, a little more attentive to making sure what I'm saying makes sense. It's important to make sure that I'm not talking healthcare business speak, which I tried not to do, but I caught myself a couple of times using words that are business speak that may not make sense to everyone in the room. So I think I'd be more attentive to that, and maybe use a few more stories.
So Deb, I have another question for you. So we've talked quite a bit about operations and some of the things that we can do to do the kinds of organizational transformations. But another very unique aspect of UNM is that, and especially UNMH, is that we're a part of a much larger community. And our mission, you know, clearly is connected to the delivery of healthcare, but I think that our external key stakeholders and partners look to us to be a part of a larger set of solutions and to be accountable to their needs and to their communities. And so could you talk a little bit about kind of looking outward and engaging key stakeholders and community groups?
Yeah, so that's important, and it's important particularly when you're the only academic medical center in the state. UAB wasn't the only, but it was the primary, and like UNM, was the only trauma, level one trauma center, was the only burn center, was the only transplant center, among other things. And so when you're in that position, it certainly does put the organization in an important role to ensuring that those services are available to the state, and really playing a leadership role in the state in being a part of this transformation. It's an expectation. And so, I go back to what I was talking about with portfolio management, and I didn't talk a lot about this, but certainly part of portfolio management is figuring out who are the right strategic partners to get the work done. And not always assuming that doing more of it yourself and alone is the right model. So in our market, in Houston, for example, we've had discussions over the last 5 years with almost every single competitor in our marketplace, looking at small ways and big ways that we can collaborate together and share patients and do pieces of the care versus trying to do all of the care. And so those discussions for me are really exciting because one of the things that drives me a little crazy about healthcare is to see two organizations in competition build the exact same resources, which is way more than a community needs. That's waste for the community, it drives up healthcare costs, no one wins in that. And so those sorts of collaborations are what are being forced to happen now by the changes in the marketplace. And so it's different, but for me that's really part of the exciting work that is going on and that's being forced by some of the change.
Good morning, my name is Michelle Campbell, and I'm a community member and a UNM graduate. And I wanted to ask a question to build on your question, or your comment about collaboration. There's great affection in the community for UNM, especially the Academic Medical Center. There's great confusion about how you access care here, unless you come in through the Level 1 Trauma Center. What would you be willing to do, and what experiences have you had in creating connections with community members and stakeholders, as well as patients, to get access to specialists and subspecialists in a way that isn't confusing and also builds the natural bonds of affection that the community holds.
Yeah, that's a great question. So that is a challenge we had at UTMB as well. UTMB, because of its history and as the first academic medical center in the state of Texas and the first medical school in the state of Texas, the local community does have great affection. And when I first arrived, we heard a lot of dissatisfaction with the ability to get in, to get into clinic. We have a really nice centralized number, one number you can call. But we built that in a way that was challenging to provide the service that patients really want. And so we had a lot of basic blocking and tackling to do internal to the organization. And we needed to, and our challenge was that we had kind of grown the ambulatory operation a little bit in a mom and pop way. So each clinic did everything the way they liked to do it and that worked for them. And the challenge with that is, how do you take that model and then blow that up over 1 million visits a year? It's hard to mom and pop 1 million visits a year. I'm going to tell you, it really is. Which means that as you grow and become a system, and if you really want to give access to patients, there has to be some level of standardization, and there has to be a process that deals with variation that's necessary. And that's what we've done at UTMB. So we've had a tremendous focus on, and this is really mundane, maybe not sound very exciting, but it's important work. We looked at scheduling templates. We partnered with our faculty to look at our new patient lag data, which says how long does it take a new patient to get an appointment, and how does that compare with everybody else in the community? And we work to educate folks on this is where you can get this care anywhere else in the community and how many days it takes to get that care. We made our own benchmarks based on that and started to fix the broken processes that were driving that experience. We had capacity, but it was unutilized because we had bad process. So now at UTMB, you can get in to see a primary care provider in 3 days. When you call as a new patient, it's 3 days. You can get in to see an orthopedic provider in 7 days. You can get in to see most of our other specialists, with a few exceptions where we just have like two faculty. And in those areas, you're going to wait longer. That's rheumatology, for example. That's almost everywhere you go. Rheumatology, it takes a while to get in. But pretty much 14 days for most of our other specialists, with the exception of where we have very significant faculty shortages. And we partner very, very closely with our department chairs and our faculty in making these changes. And we actually have emergency plans. So as we see new patient lag go up, we pull the emergency plan and execute the emergency plan, which may mean changing the mix of patient appointments to be able to get new patients in. It may mean having an additional clinic, those sorts of things. But those emergency plans were developed by the departments, not by us. We were there to help facilitate that. The development of those and execute those, but that's been the partnership that's necessary to fix those processes. Thank you. Do you have a question?
And thank you for your time this morning. My name is Steve Bass. I'm a nurse, and I am the unit director for the medical ICU. I started at the University Hospital in 1989. I met my wife here. Two of my four children were born here. Sheena has been present for that entire time in one capacity or another. We've had the good fortune up to this point of having a CEO who is also very much familiar and part of our family. And I'm from that perspective, I'm still wondering, why do you want to come to the University Hospital in Albuquerque, New Mexico? My second part to that question is my passion, my daily work, my why is supporting the work that's being done at the bedside, supporting the work that is going to get us the outcomes that we need to have. Dr. Liu's team, the nursing team, housekeepers, facilities, all of those people that are in there making sure that the things that are working. And my staff, I think, would tell you in a nutshell that what they face on a daily basis are barriers to them being able to be at the bedside doing the work that they want to be doing. So the second part of my question is, how do you support me in supporting that work on the daily basis?
Mm-hmm. So as a unit manager? Okay. So I think the way I've done this in the past, and I'd have to know more to learn how this would work here, but things I've done in the past to help support our unit managers are, first, to make sure that you have the time to do the important work, to be present in the environment, to make sure you have a structure that supports you. So at UTMB, we developed unit-based clinical leadership and partnered our nurse managers and our physicians together and worked with them to support them in solving the problems of the unit, right? Because your best position as nurse manager and the medical director, you've got the best line of sight. So we provided a structure for collaboration and then supported those dyads with education, with sometimes coaching, with resources, bringing resources into the organization to help support that work, and then get out of the way and let you do it. And so that is how we've approached that at UTMB. We also have developed over the course of my 5 years a new manager training program. We've established leader standard work, so everyone in a management role understands what's the expectation on a daily, weekly, monthly basis of me as a manager. What are the habits we want to have as a leadership and a management team that will allow us to transform the organization and allow us to improve the care? So that's some of the work at UTMB. And I guess I would kind of repeat what I talked about earlier about why here. For me, this organization is interesting because of its history and because of the important role it plays in the state. I'm looking at academic medical center CEO roles, and I have been for a while. This one attracted me because of the transformation that is being asked for in the organization, and the history the role of the institution in the state. I also got to spend a little time in Albuquerque over the weekend. It's a beautiful place. I got to bike the Bosque Trail and went, and that picture is from the tram after I let go of the death grip I had on the back of the tram rail. I snapped a quick photo. I'm afraid of heights. It looks like a wonderful place to live from my perspective. And I'm really, I really feel connected to the mission and the history of this organization, which is what drew me in initially to the interview process. Thanks.
Okay, honestly, this is the last question.
Okay.
I feel like wishes or whatever.
Okay,
so you brought up to a long, you know, Steve really made me think about this. So you're talking about, you know, transforming the front line, empowering people, and a culture of tolerating innovation and tolerating failure, really, like you said. And so historically, that has not been the case here. That people, I'll only speak for myself.
Yeah, okay.
Feel that innovation sometimes is either discouraged or punished, especially, and if you fail, the consequences are dire. So what have you done to create a supportive environment where that culture of innovation and tolerating failure can grow?
Yeah, so we're doing work, and this is gonna be a small scale example, and this, doing that at a global scale in an organization takes leadership alignment across the school, the health system, together to create that healthy work environment, which I talked about. We have a number of value-based contracts, and we also have a block grant program through Medicaid in Texas, because we didn't take the Medicaid expansion, where we're doing outcome-based, outcome-based innovations, and we've got money at risk for that. And so we've put teams together, and we're letting them do small tests of change, and we're explaining up front, this might work, or this might not work. But when it doesn't work, spending time reflecting on, this didn't work, but why? Why didn't it work? What can we learn from it? What did work about it? Because sometimes you do something and a piece of it works, but the bigger piece didn't. So let's learn from that and deploy it somewhere else. So a big part of that is reflection. And you are not alone as an organization in what you described. Every academic medical center I've ever been in has wanted innovation, but and tried different things to create an environment that would support that. But there's something that doesn't always quite click. And so it's hard work. I think it starts with a healthy work environment. So how do we interact? How do we recognize failure? I actually have a practice of writing notes, which I did before Studer. And I write notes to people and thank them when they try something and it didn't work. So that they know that, hey, just trying actually mattered to me. And it didn't work, but that's okay, because we learned these three things from that thing that doesn't work. But those things would have to be scaled to be able to make an organizational impact. What we've been doing within the value-based contracting work and the block grant work that I described is more small, rapid test of change and working with a small group of people and getting them comfortable to get outside of the box of what we usually do or how we usually think about things. And there we're trying more, how do we make things happen automatically? So every patient that is supposed to get a mammogram now at UTMB, if you haven't done it within the time frame, you get a call and we schedule it for you. I call that suggest-to-selling. The fast food industry does that to us with French fries, right? So we're suggest-to-selling our preventative health care. We call you and we make it really easy for you to get your preventative health care. And then if you don't show up for your colonoscopy, as many people don't because they don't, who really wants to have a colonoscopy, no one. And so what we do, what we're doing now is creating opportunities for you to get fit testing if that's appropriate and that to happen automatically versus somebody having to remember to do that. We'll see if that works. That's gonna be, that's a change, a test of change we're trying. We don't know if that'll work or not. But we are acknowledging that some of this stuff we're doing is new and might work and it might not work.
So Deb, thank you very much. Thanks for being a part of this process and for sharing today your vision with us. And you know, also for kind of planting the seed for, you know, a new word in our organizational lexicon, which I'm sure that I will hear again before the end of the week. But, you know, also thank you for what you do for healthcare. You know, for all the transformation that you've done in the communities where you've been and for the work that you do with Vizient, which helps impact our organization. And so I think that this has been a great conversation today. But before we conclude, you know, I need to say thank you to everyone in the audience because, you know, this is a critical process, and you being here today will help us select the right leader for UNM Hospital, and your participation is critical for us to be able to do that. But also thank you for all the things that you do to make UNM a great place for the clinical care that you do. You know, I think that Deb kind of talked about it, and everyone that's been up here has talked about the fact that while we have our challenges and healthcare has our challenges, that there are some very special things about being at this organization. And they are the fact that we have, you know, undoubtedly some of the most mission-driven, committed individuals. And you get up every day and you do the incredible hard work of healthcare. and that you take care of our patients, and our families, and our communities. And for that, it makes me very proud to be a part of this organization. It makes it very proud for me to be able to say, we've attracted great candidates like Deb who want to come and be a part of our team. So thank you very much for all of that. So if you could please remember to fill out your evaluations. Your input is really important. And thank you again, and I hope everyone has a great day.